Good morning once again. Welcome to the Rush Hour Show. I am Lydia Lacuaniero. Now, in the studio with me are two professionals who are going to have a chat with us. We have Dr. Amina Zawede, who is the Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of ICT. We also have Soma Muchala Fuzia, who is the Public Relations Manager at Huawei Technologies in Uganda. We're going to be chatting about ICT and AI and its role in development and day-to-day runnings, you know, of companies and also in the lives of Ugandans. Ladies, welcome. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lydia.
Yeah. I'll begin with you, Dr. Amina Zawede. You recently had the ICT job fair, and what was it all about? Just to ask about that.
Good morning to you, all our viewers. Yes, I think about last week, but one, about 2 weeks ago, we had our National ICT Job Fair, which is a platform that is aimed at creating opportunities for employment, opportunities for internships, and opportunities for training for our young people. It was our second annual ICT Job Fair. We had our first one last year. Mm-hmm. In 2022, and it was hosted at Makerere University, when Makerere was commemorating its 100 years. We had our first job fair. If it was anything to be compared with, that is the first, and this one, this time around, we had over 10,000 opportunities in internships, in training, in job placements, and also scholarships. The His Excellency the President was the graced the function. The Vice President was also there, so it's eminent that the leadership of this country is not only supportive of ensuring that we create employment opportunities for our people, but it's also fully involved and engaged in this affair. We are conversant of the fact that the majority of the population in this country, we have a total population close to 45 million, and over 30 million are young people below the age of 30. And we churn out 30,000 graduates every year from universities that we have in this country. So there is need for them to look and seek for employment. And these opportunities, you know, it's not very easy to get jobs. And even for those at universities, it's not very easy to get internship placements. But if the ministry has come up with this arrangement where, you know, you come and get to know what are the companies, what are the organizations that we have in the country and even outside the country, you know, as we have these job fairs, we are attracting both national and international, you know, companies to come and showcase the opportunities they have to offer for our young people. Mm-hmm. Then we also have sponsors, or people who have supported us to have this show or fair a success. We have Huawei Technologies, who have been key in supporting this ICT job fair right from the first one, the second one. We are moving with them yes. throughout the series. And this time around, we had Next Media was also part of the sponsors, Airtel, MTN, and so many others have come, you know, to support us to ensure that we address this pertinent, you know, issue and concern for our country.
Yes. Yeah. Oh, thank you very much, Dr. Zawede. And now, Fuzia, I wanted to ask, we hear people talk a lot about AI these days. Everyone, it's just the rave, AI this, AI that. Tell us more about its ability to transform the lives of Ugandans.
Thank you very much, Lydia, and I would also like to take this opportunity to greet everyone who's watching, all the viewers, and thank you for hosting us, Aban TV, by the names of Soma Muchala Fuzia. And yes, so when we talk about AI, first of all, what is AI? We need to understand what that is. So for me, what I believe AI is this is a development because for one to even know what it can do in someone's life, you have to know what it is. In full, that's artificial intelligence.
Yes.
And what it is, to me, I believe it is the development of different computer systems. And these different computer systems also need things that have to do with human intelligence. AI could not exist if humans were not in existence.
Yeah.
So we have various things to do with problem solving, learning, and so many other things that we could talk about in artificial intelligence. So when you talk about how artificial intelligence can help in or can support in any way in a Ugandan person's life, I would say AI will actually enhance different sectors in different ways. For example, the health sector. Let me just put it in layman's language. If within the health sector, we've already started using AI, but maybe people just don't know.
They don't know yet.
Yes, because you go for blood tests, and within a few minutes, something has come out, your results have come out.
Mm.
It's because these are systems that have been trained with human intelligence over and over again, that if you see this cell and this cell together, it means maybe you're positive or you're negative.
Yeah.
Yes, so already we are already on that journey. But if we apply it a lot more in our lifestyles, in our health, in the education sector or agriculture as well, we'll be able to have better overall livelihoods, mm-hmm. I should say. Mm-hmm. Everything becomes smoother, everything becomes easier. That's what I can say in general for artificial intelligence.
Artificial intelligence. So thank
yes.
you very much. I'll come back to you, Dr. Zawede. Youth employment is a huge issue right now. It is the topic that is everyone is talking about it right now for the past couple of years, as you have mentioned. Now, what are you doing to address this challenge?
The challenge of youth unemployment, of
yes.
course, the ICT Job Fair is one of those
yes.
Initiatives that we have put in place. I know as the years go by, it's going to get bigger and bigger. We'll get more, companies, like I said, or entities coming to offer opportunities for our young people. And we started with the central, region. We have had the first fair was in Makerere University, second one in Kololo. We are now going to go to different regions outside
yes.
Kampala. So next year we expect to be either in the north, east or west, wherever we are going to, decide we'll have it. And then we shall start having, regional fairs, because these unemployed citizens that we have are all over the country. The other initiative that the Ministry of ICT and National Guidance is focusing on is the potential that business process outsourcing has. Business process outsourcing is, like Soma said, when you're going to talk about a concept, it's better that your audience understands what you're talking about. Business process outsourcing is you being able to do work for an entity but outside that entity.
Mm.
An example is, an accountant can do accounting work for an organization from wherever they are. A computer science can develop a system or work on an application outside the organization.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. We have the basic example I'll talk about today is that we have, for example, house helps. You can do cook food as yourself, but because you have to go work and do other duties, you bring somebody to help you do that work at home. So that is an outsourcing function as well. So there are many companies globally, even nationally here, that need to focus on their core business but bring in other people to do some or organizations to do the work for them. For example, printing mm-hmm. services. If it is a hospital, they need people to do administration, so you don't have to be a nurse or a doctor and you don't have to sit in that hospital, but you can work from anywhere in Uganda for a hospital in the US, you can work in Uganda for India and so many others. So that is what business process outsourcing is. Because of the number of youths that we have who are unemployed, we can leverage all these opportunities to create employment for them.
Mm-hmm.
We also have a national, skilling program. because that is aimed at building more capacity and efficiency of our youths. When people get out of universities, for lawyers, they go to LDC to improve the way they work. For accountants, sometimes they do, you know, professional courses like SCC and so on. In the IT field, we have training institutions and certifications that are helping, you know, these youths to become more professional at what they are doing. The ministry has also set up business process outsourcing and an innovation council. This council is a council of experts that have representation from government, from academia, from private sector, and civil society as well, and also public relations. Because as we do business process outsourcing, we also have to market our country.
Yes.
Because these, you know, these what we want to avoid is brain drain.
Yes.
Therefore, we are saying, you know, we have our youths here. We don't want you to take them out of our country. They can work from here. But these are the opportunities that Uganda has. These are the incentives that we are giving you if you come and take on maybe 1,000 people to employ or 500. So this BPO and Innovation Council has supported the ministry to come up with a policy, the BPO policy that we are taking to cabinet to bless and approve, so that it can support us to seek and create opportunities for attracting more companies to come and take on our people. In this policy, we have what we need to make BPO to thrive. The government has a role to play. The private sector has a role to play. Our young people also have a role to play in this. So that is the kind of, you know, setup and initiatives we are putting in place. And I will talk about, of course, others as we go on, because we also need internet and so many, you know, and so many other things to be put in place.
Thank you very much, Dr. Zawede. And now, Soma, I just wanted you to tell us, what are the common uses and applications of AI?
Thank you very much for that question. As I had actually earlier said, that AI can actually revolutionize and also improve the overall well-being of human beings. AI has a broad, I should say it has a broad range of applications.
Yes.
And I'll just give a basic example to the viewers. Like the chat box we have, these are virtual personal assistants. Mm. And this is AI that operates that. The virtual personal assistants, those are chat box where, you know, these things where you go online, maybe you say on a website,
yes.
For example, maybe say you come to a website or the Ministry of ICT's website, and maybe say there is a chat box there mm-hmm. for help. It's not that there is somebody behind there. Usually these computer systems have already been trained to respond to people accordingly. Actually, even on the, for example, the application for NSSF itself, I've been helped a couple of times because of that chatbot. And usually it's automated. They already know the type of questions people
that
are
you're going
to ask, and they already automated the responses. And should you have a more detailed or more complicated situation, they will direct you to a call number. Mm. Maybe there is that. And then we, like I already said, we also have health diagnostics. Just an earlier example that I had given about the use of AI, we're already using that for health. And then we also have maybe in the near future, Uganda could also tap into artificial intelligence for agriculture,
yes.
I should say. In different countries, according to where Huawei is deployed, we have witnessed some countries have different solutions that monitor farms, mm-hmm. and these are operated with artificial intelligence. For example, through artificial intelligence, the algorithms will be able to tell which part of the farm maybe is infested with a specific disease. This is through use of drones. The drone will fly above the farm, and this drone will use those algorithms to detect which area could have more. It detects using temperature. Some areas are more cool than the other, others are more warm than the other. And through this, it's trained that if this color, this area, maybe say this crop turns into a specific color, say red, and then it has a temperature that is maybe say 70 degrees or so, that means it is infested by a specific disease. Oh, wow. So these are solutions that have been trained. These are systems that have been trained so that it makes work easier for a human being. Yes.
Oh, thank you very much, Soma. Now, Dr. Zawede, earlier on, you had mentioned that the national BPO policy is ready. What does it entail?
Some of the things that the BPO policy entails, I mentioned earlier, but let me give you a bit of statistics on why this BPO is really very important before I come to what it entails. Because as we look for employment opportunities for our people, what we are aiming at is that, you know, when people are employed, also the government earns from, you know, people being employed, because they will be remitting taxes and generating revenue for this country. Globally, in 2020, the BPO industry was valued at $163 billion, and it is expected to grow to $183 billion by the end of this year. In about 3 months' time, we shall be counting, you know, up to $183 billion that this industry generates. You find countries like India are generating a lot of revenue from this, South Korea, Philippines. So, and we're seeing, you know, if these countries, and they're also, they also, some of them started, like South Korea was at the same level as Uganda at one time, but they're now ahead of us.
Yes.
India is a developing country. Uganda is a developing country as well. So we have a lot of potential and capacity for us to also benefit from that, from the opportunities that BPO has. When it comes to Uganda alone, with the several initiatives we have, the 200,000 jobs that we expect to create, our anticipation is that we can have over $1 billion out of this market of BPO as a country. So that is why all effort is being put towards ensuring that we create these opportunities for our young people. Now, what does the policy have? Of course, for BPO to succeed, you have to have the right infrastructure in place. And you have to have the right incentives in place, like, you know, the cost of internet. You have to have effective internet. Soma is talking about artificial intelligence. You can also do BPO. You can also do BPO with, you can do artificial intelligence under BPO. I was looking for, is it BPO with artificial intelligence or artificial intelligence with BPO? But yes, under the BPO sector, artificial intelligence, blockchain, and so many other emerging technologies that we see can be done. So we are putting in place, first of all, in the policy, allowing that, you know, we have to first of all brand our country as a destination for IT-enabled services or BPO investment. We have to give incentives to those people who are employing our young people, incentives like, you know, tax waivers or tax holidays for a period, for to allow them to attract as many people as possible into their institutions. We also have, we know that for us to, you know, have BPO succeed, people have to have gadgets and devices or have the right settings. So how to, do we make sure that these devices are affordable?
Yes.
So those are some of, you know, the things that this policy has in place. We have to create awareness, and we also have to ensure that we have the right talent. You know, when you go and market yourself that this is how good I am, when someone comes, or this is how good a cook I am, when someone comes to taste your food, they have to really get what you are marketing and promoting. So we also have to prepare that the youths, our talent, to have the right talent that is attractive to the BPO industry. So we are giving recommendations on how we can standardize that talent for us to be able to be ready for the BPO markets.
Thank you so much, Dr. Yeah. Zawede. Now, Dr. Soma, earlier on you talked about the common uses of AI. So I just want to know, for those who may be watching and they're a bit concerned that AI is now different, it can be used really in almost every facet of life. Is AI coming to take jobs?
That's an interesting question. I wouldn't say that AI is coming to take away people's jobs, but rather to augment them, or in simple terms to say to enhance or to make our work ethic better. Because just like I had earlier said, I will still go back to the definition of AI. These are computer systems that are developed with the use of human intelligence.
Okay.
To some extent, there is every, of course, like you're saying, that people are concerned about this AI maybe say coming to wipe out the jobs, but it will actually instead help in different ways. For example, it will help in proper decision makings for people and to reduce on repetitive tasks that we human beings do sometimes.
Okay.
I'll give an example. Maybe say you and me, we are given a task, or maybe you give me a task. Actually so many tasks, because in that one task there are so many other tasks within it, so that I'm able to complete a full assignment. So if there is something like the, if the, these solutions are actually there, the artificial intelligence where I am working, it will help me to be able to make sure I do not repeat some things. If there are some, let me say I have made a report and I have put it in the system and I've said these are the things I have to do, it will actually make it easier, because there is actually something that's going to help you tick on all the boxes instead of you having to go back and repeat to do some of these things. And it will actually also help you to break down some of these tasks so that you're able to also delegate them to other people. So for me, I would say it will actually lead to more or newer job opportunities or different more opportunities. I wouldn't say artificial intelligence is coming
to take jobs.
Take away the jobs. Yes, yes, yes.
And also, has AI been deployed anywhere in Uganda?
AI, I would say, like we have just talked about health.
Yes.
I don't think you're going to go to any lab and they'll say, oh, you first. I don't even know which other, because we've all been raised seeing different ways that now they put your blood samples in a machine. And after a few minutes, it will come.
Yeah.
All that is already artificial intelligence. And I'm sure that next week there's supposed to be, I think, a science week. And we have some of our SMEs that are hosting some of these solutions, artificial intelligence solutions, on our cloud platforms. And I'm sure they'll be able to showcase them at the science week, which will take place, I think, next week. And these are young people that have made an application that is supposed to do automated sales using artificial intelligence. And these are Ugandans, young, brilliant Ugandans, doing very great things, things we don't think, maybe the main public might not think have already come to Uganda, but it's because maybe we also haven't yet opened up our minds to adopt some of these things. But these things are already here in Uganda. So I also encourage people to go for the science week so that they're able to witness
see for
some
themselves.
Of these things. Yes. Yes.
Thank you so much.
Actually, let me also give you an example
yes.
of artificial intelligence. I have, you know, I am an academician and a researcher. In my life before becoming a PS, I was supervising research students. I had a student who did her PhD in using a mobile phone to do a microscopic analysis of a blood sample. You know, back in the days, they used to do the blood culture or analysis under the microscope.
Yes.
But now, because for you to use a microscope, you have to be a a specialist in doing that.
Absolutely.
Or a lab technician or somebody. Mm. However, with the cases of growing malaria all over, you know, the country, you find that you cannot have lab technicians to analyze or do the culture of this malaria, the blood sample for malaria across the country.
Yes.
And yet we have people across the country, you know, falling sick. So anybody who has a mobile phone, any nurse can be able to, you know, they'll take off the blood sample and then using this mobile phone, they'll do a scan of that blood sample and then you'll be able to get results
on whether, fascinating.
On whether this, you know, you have malaria plus plus or plus or negative. So it is true and I have seen it. Actually, this student, she's now Dr. Rose Nakasi. Because she graduated. But she has now got funding from Google to expand this project, to scale it up and even do analysis of, you know, cell, testing blood for cell, you know, for cancer cells, for malaria and also for tuberculosis, I think. So, you know, there are a lot of initiatives. There's an artificial intelligence lab in Makerere University as well where people are doing a lot of this. There's also one of my colleagues who did, who did, I think, research in identifying cassava mosaic, you know, for cassava. So a farmer can also just use their mobile phone, you know, take a picture of an infected leaf, and then we'll be able to determine is this cassava mosaic or not.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow. They so have AI also done. AI is all
those
over.
Are brilliant.
There is
innovations.
Also there is also an application that can be able to translate real time into currently 7 local languages using artificial intelligence. I think that has been developed by Sunbird. It's a Sunbird AI. It's called Sunbird Artificial Intelligence Company. So, you know, as I speak here today, the PS Ministry of ICT, my Honorable Minister of ICT, Dr. Chris Bariomosi, my Ministers of State, Honorable Kaviang and Honorable Joyce, when we are speaking, we have to speak to each and everybody in the country. Absolutely. And the best way to communicate is to communicate in the language that people understand.
Yes.
Because English is our official language, but I believe Muchara here would understand Chinese or Lusonga better. Someone else would understand Itesot better or what. Yes. So, this application is translating real time. So if we can scale it up to the 52 dialects we have in this country, you know what, an amazing job.
Communication made easy.
Yeah, communication will be made easy.
Made so much easier.
And AI will be appreciated.
Wow.
So we are not far from it. We are implementing it and all these examples are live.
Absolutely.
You know,
thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Zawede. We'll now take a short break and we'll be right back. Welcome back. You're still watching the Rush Hour, and we continue with our discussion on ICT and AI. With me in the studio are the two experts. We have Dr. Amina Zawede, who is the permanent secretary in the Ministry of ICT. Then we've also got Soma Muchala-Fuzia, who is the public relations manager at Huawei Technologies Uganda. Ladies, thank you for staying on and having this discussion with us. Dr. Zawede, I'm going to ask you to lead us into our second segment of this discussion. Now, the government has identified informational technology as a big driver of development. So what is Uganda doing to meaningfully realize the benefits that ICT has the potential to deliver?
Well, Lydia, thanks. That's an interesting question. An intention to deliver. Yes, of course, the public expects to see, you know, delivery from government. Mm. What are we giving back, to the citizens? For the Ministry of ICT and National Guidance, this ministry is leading the digital transformation agenda for this country. And therefore, any improvement in connectivity or service we see, if people have gadgets and what, it is our, responsibility. So knowing that we need, and ICT has to be, realized in a systematic manner, we came up with our first ever digital transformation roadmap. This digital transformation roadmap was launched in August this year by the Vice President, Her Excellency Jessica Alupo. Now, that roadmap is a five-year strategy or a five-year journey that we want to walk as this, we want this country to walk, starting from this year. And then you count 5 years, it will be about 2028. So we have, Uganda has the Digital Uganda Vision 2040, we have the National Development Plan, and so many other plans that have been set up by government for and have set targets. What do we want to realize by 2040? What do we want to see the country as in terms of ICT and, many other priorities that government has? However, for us to move systematically and focused on how to realize these targets has not been in place. So we have set ourselves, milestones. We want to see what we have achieved every 5 years until we get to 2040, so that we don't get to 2040 and we are surprised that, oh my gosh, maybe I missed this, I didn't get that right.
Yes.
So in this, for these years, we have identified five priorities that are very key and necessary for the digital transformation or ICT transformation journey. The first one is infrastructure and connectivity. We need to have internet across the country, and we are looking at all inclusiveness. We don't want to be blamed for focusing services in the center or the central business district, but we want to have inclusivity, have connectivity to sub counties, to parishes, to the last mile, the citizen. And therefore, we are putting a lot of effort in ensuring that we grow this connectivity. Government has now acquired two loans, one by World Bank and another by the Chinese Exim Bank, that are going to expand the connectivity we have, and we expect that, that by the end of these 5 years we'll have reached over about 80% coverage of the entire country. Then the next area of priority is, and of course when we talk about infrastructure, it's not about connectivity alone. We also need data centers where to have our data stored. We are currently storing a lot of our data as a country on servers outside the country or outside the continent, which becomes very expensive. And also you risk, there's a risk on, who is viewing my data, or who is seeing it. But as government, we have a national data center, and we need to have more, data centers. We also need to have computers, and gadgets. That is all part of infrastructure. And then the next emphasis is on digital services. If you have the infrastructure, then now we want to take services online. Soma has been giving us examples of artificial intelligence. All those are services that we are offering to the people.
Absolutely.
As government, we also need to digitize a government, to create efficiency in government, how do we process data? How do we, manipulate it? How do we use it to support us in decision making? Because, you know, the world is moving away from second guessing and, you know, guesswork in terms of decision making. We have to be articulate and specific. For example, if as a government we want to construct schools or hospitals, which areas do we need them in? Which, how many people are in these areas? Recently we are now implementing the parish development model.
Yes.
And we have developed a parish development management information system. Mm. Now with this system we are registering each and every household in this country. We shall be able to know how many households do we have, how many people do we have, how many. We are also profiling the parishes. What are the services in these parishes? What is the infrastructure? Do they have roads? What kind of roads? How many schools do they have? How many people are in this parish? You find, you know, there is one instance where we found that children, young children, are walking a distance of about 5 to 10 kilometers to go to school.
Wow.
Because there is no school in this parish, the next school is 10 kilometers away.
Oh,
so
wow.
If we have that data, mm-hmm. then it informs where to put a school.
Yes.
People were walking kilometers, mothers, to go and give birth because the next hospital is over 5 kilometers away. So mm-hmm. someone gets into labor
and they have to be transported.
Either be ridden on a bicycle or what, you can imagine.
Yes.
All that goes on without, you know, information to make a decision. So people would be blaming, maybe government is not thinking about us, but probably it's because we have not collected
the data.
So whenever you have data, it makes life easy, makes planning easy, makes decision making easy. The other priority is cyber security and data protection and privacy. We have all these systems going online today. We see even banking. I don't know how many people don't do banking online. Of course, we have the digital divide. You find some people still go to the bank and queue, but banks have taken all their services online.
Yes.
You can transact online, you can check your balances online, you can pay online, you can now use mobile money and so on and so forth. However, for those that have not gone online, have a fear of their money
might be
being stolen, or they are scared of the fraudulent acts
yes.
that are going on because it's too common today. So we have to build capacity in cybersecurity. That is the technical capacity to ensure that our systems are secure, but also create awareness around cybersecurity. You know, some individuals expose themselves to this, you know, cyber insecurity. Why? Because if I take an example of a house or a home, if you're going to sleep and you don't close your windows, or you don't make sure that door is locked, if you wake up and everything has been stolen out of your house, are you going to blame the thief or
yourself?
Are you going to blame yourself
for not being
so yeah of? So sometimes people are leaving their devices, you know, their devices don't have passwords, or they have shared the password, they have shared the mobile PIN, mobile money PIN, and so on and so forth. So if we continue to educate people about this, then we shall be able to transact in a secure environment. Mm. The fourth priority is skilling, digital skilling. If we take all these services online and people don't know how to use them, it will be a waste of time.
Mm.
Just like if you give a child a present or a gift of a book and they don't know how to read it, it will be a waste of time. So these services are being developed, but we should also educate the people on how to navigate these applications. For example, a farmer, if you want the farmer to know information about when do they farm, where do they find the seed to grow, where do they find the fertilizers, where do they find the pesticides, where do they get the market, where do they get the storage for their, you know, for their surplus that they have not sold, they will not get this information if they can't use this mobile phone. So there's a lot we need to do in digital scaling for the basic users, for the advanced users, like the people doing artificial intelligence. If we have to grow that capacity, we have to have so many people skilled in that area, or even graduates up to PhD level and beyond. Then the last priority is innovation and entrepreneurship. All the the examples we have given since morning when we sat here are innovations.
Yes.
People have sat and thought about what are the challenges we are facing as a country? What problems do we need to solve? And no one is going to solve those problems apart from ourselves because we know them best. If we are saying we are going to go and get a solution from, I'm using China because Soma is representing Huawei. If we are saying we are going to buy a solution from China, you know how long it takes to get from China to Uganda. So the solution will be costs, will be expensive, will be very hard to maintain because people will have to be flying in to come and maintain the system. Yeah? But if we support our young people, our innovators, to give them the right space and facilitation and the right environment to grow their solutions, to give them even the basic skills of, because it's not only IT, you also have to teach them to market their products, do business plans, identify what's the cost-benefit analysis of, you know, production of this whole system. Then we shall be able to grow a lot of, lots more innovations. I'm going to give you an example of one of these countries that has grown leveraging on innovation. Estonia has 99.9% of all its operations online.
Wow.
Everything is done online, and they say the only paper they have is toilet paper.
So that's hilarious.
Yeah. So everything is done online. The only thing they don't do online is, you know, the tail end of the divorce process.
Yes.
Because you do application of divorce online,
everything
but I think they
done.
Give you time. Yeah. To really think about it, you might change your mind. Maybe I'm not encouraging people to separate.
So
to test, maybe to test your reactions or feelings towards that. Yeah. So these people have grown lots of innovations. I don't know whether you know about Skype.
Yes.
Skype is an Estonian product. Bolt. You know Bolt, Uber, is also an Estonian product.
Wow.
And these innovations are bringing billions of shillings
for
this country every year. So even us, we can. Because we already have self-border. You know, the likes of self-border are innovations. There is this mobile lab. I've forgotten the name.
Rocket Health.
Yeah, Rocket Health. You know, the likes of Rocket Health. All these are, you know, innovations or initiatives that have been brought in place. People are now delivering groceries online, especially after COVID.
Yes.
During COVID, we all appreciated the need of being online. If anyone didn't have, actually the people who had their services online at that time really made a lot of money. Because yes, people were at home. People fell sick, medicine was delivered at home. People fell sick, you know, blood samples would come and be taken from home. They need fruits or groceries, they are delivered.
At your doorstep.
At everything. And that is the comfort in which, or convenience, I don't even want to call it comfort, because people say when you get too comfortable, then it brings health issues. You won't be able
That's
to.
True. But I guess
you
it
know,
is convenience.
Yes. Yeah, but yeah, it is convenience. You can get things done anywhere, anytime. In any place, and that is how the world needs to be, in a transparent
well,
and
efficient thank you so much, Dr. Zawede. Now, Soma, I just wanted to ask, are there any dangers that must be guarded against while using AI? Earlier on, Dr. Zawede touched a bit about cybersecurity.
Yes, of course, I won't say that there are no dangers. Everything has pros and cons. Of course, before we think about anything, we have to know that coexisting with such solutions require a lot of responsible development and also deployment. So we know that such solutions have issues sometimes, like maybe say data privacy, cybersecurity issues like Doctor had just talked about earlier, and also things to do with transparency in the way the solutions are made. I think some of these are things that people are supposed to know about. And also the risk of making, you know, because we say AI is something trained by the human beings, the human mind, you've trained it to do something, but sometimes it could make mistakes. So those are maybe say some of the dangers or the risks that could with such solutions, but I believe that if we have better regulations that could help to maybe say, or laws that would help with making sure that these solutions are used in a proper manner, in a more responsible manner, then I believe that some of these issues would be reduced.
Mm.
Yes, and that's why we would need a lot of collaboration with, say, the government, with different communities and private companies together to come up with these policies and regulations so that everyone is able to understand how, say, your solutions work, maybe, say, from your entity, so that the government is able to put in place these policies that are suitable for everyone, but also while protecting the citizens of its country. Yes.
Thank you so much, Soma. We are also running out of time, so I'll just ask that each of us give just a closing word for the viewers who are watching. We'll start with you, Dr. Zawede.
First of all, thank you very much, Lydia, for hosting us. Thank you very much, our viewers this morning on Urban TV, for listening to us. One is a few words that I have to tell you is to appreciate the beauty of digitization, and for the young people out there to really embrace digitization, because it has three main things. It is creating employment opportunities like we have identified throughout this program. It also addresses these issues of corruption, because when you have systems are transparent, systems are efficient and effective, you don't have things to do with middlemen. These days they say kitu kidogo is not there, because you can't tell a machine, you can't
give
bribe
me
a machine.
Machine give me kitu kidogo.
You know, let me just give a little example. There is a time, the first time I used a machine, you know, I was checking in for travel, and this airport had no person at the check-in counter. It was a machine. And the machine had the maximum weight of your bag as 23 kilograms. Previously, if your bag was over 23, it was 23.5 or 24, you bargain and plead.
And somehow.
Yeah, please, you know, and then the bag passes. But you put the other machine,
yes,
it will just say, you know, you're overweight. Can't. And then you have to deal with yourself. So that is, you know, that is the beauty of digitization. It keeps things, you know, transparent and open and efficient. And then lastly, it is also an avenue to create, they call it equalizer, you know, equity.
Yes.
Because there is no, the ICT is not for the rich, is not for the rich or for the,
or for the poor.
We
yes.
all embrace it in the same manner.
Absolutely.
And therefore, as a country, as government, we are here to serve all you youths wherever you are in accelerating digital transformation. So embrace it, because we are creating opportunities, ensuring that we have connectivity everywhere. Now we are taking job fairs to the various regions.
Mm-hmm.
When we get there, please be able to embrace them and go on our website to access all the information that you need to, and any updates about the opportunities that we have to offer.
Thanks so much, Dr. Zawede. Now, Soma?
For me, mine is very brief. I would just say, I would encourage everyone to embrace a lifelong mindset change system for your own self.
Mm-hmm.
Create, make sure that you're able to accept change. Just also help yourself to improve on different skills that you have. For example, now we have been speaking about artificial intelligence. There are different entities out there that are skilling people in these solutions, in these ICTs. For example, even with Huawei, we have what we call the Huawei ICT Academy, which has been offering free artificial intelligence trainings. We actually registered a number of people at the ICT job fair who are interested in this course, and these people are going to be trained for free. So I encourage you all to embrace the new changes that are coming in this life. ICT is now the new normal. This is the new life that we are living in. And because the country also has to move forward, no one is going to be left behind.
Mm-hmm.
So in order to we have to have a better you to also have a better Uganda.
Yes.
That's a slogan that we use at Huawei. So I would like to wish you all a happy month, And yes, I believe we shall see people at the Science Week so that they are able to understand,
to understand more,
yes,
of what
more
we are talking about.
Other future fairs that the Ministry of ICT will also be able to organize. Yes. Mm-hmm. So thank you very much and thank you for watching.
Well, thank you once again, ladies. That was Soma Muchala Fuzia, who is the Public Relations Manager at Huawei Uganda. We also had Dr. Amin Wende, who is the Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of ICT. We have been discussing ICT and artificial intelligence, and that is what we are talking about a lot in the country right now. It is the future of Uganda. Up next is Rush Talk. Miles Ramiti will be taking you from 9 to 10 a.m. Thank you very much for watching. I am Lydia Lakonyero, and you have a great day.